We'll rant and we'll roar like two British sailors. We'll rant and we'll roar all on the salt seas until we strike soundings in the channel of old England from a Chantecilly. 'Tis 35 leagues.
We hove our ship to with a wind from sou'west, boys. We hove our ship to for to strike soundings clear. It's 45 fathoms with a white sandy bottom. We squared our main yard and up channel did steer.
We'll rant and we'll roar like true British sailors. We'll rant and we'll roar all on the salt seas until we strike soundings in the channel of old England from Ushant to Scilly. 'Tis 35 leagues.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to another exciting virtual experience with Pretty Gritty Tours and your host this evening, the Foss Waterway Seaport. Tonight, as you may have already guessed, is a little bit new and certainly more exciting than some of the previous stuff I've done. I would like to welcome your champions this evening. We are going to be doing a history of Captain George Vancouver in the Puget Sound area. And then these fine people joining me tonight are going to compete in a ridiculous game show that I have made up on the spot just for them. Before we really get into that, I'd like to just give an opportunity to introduce each of your people here tonight. Starting up at the top, a dear friend of mine, Jackie Richter, whose family actually made the majority of their income bringing a new breed of sheep into Washington State. Mm-hmm. She has since expanded on that agricultural knowledge to come here tonight as a prime sheep historian, which I think will come in very handy for the nautical voyages of Captain George Vancouver. Thank you for joining us tonight, Jackie.
You're welcome.
Immediately down here, we have Kayla, who you may have seen at one point working in the seaport, though probably not because everything's been shut down due to a pandemic. But she herself is actually the next in line to the Rainier Beer Fortune. And as a brewing and hops historian expert, she will be, I think, invaluable to this trivia team. And then certainly not least, but definitely last tonight, we have Mr. Lucas Miller, who will be joining us tonight. And he actually broke out in the world of maritime science by discovering a series of doll-shaped anchors at the bottom of Mariana Trench. And having retrieved those individually, he comes to us now with a vast amount of historic knowledge. So thank you all for joining us.
Thank you.
Obviously, almost everything that I just said right there is complete fabrication, so you should have a really good flavor for how the night is going to go. The way that we're going to do this is, after I give you guys a bunch of Vancouver knowledge, everyone in the comment section tonight gets to choose one of these fine champions to represent them. So you'll either write Jackie, Kayla, or Lucas in the comments, and that's your vote for who you think is going to win our trivia section. If you've chosen correctly by the end of the true or false fact or fiction section and your champion wins, you are going to be entered into a random drawing to be eligible for, if I can find it here, this very good looking prize package courtesy of the Foss Waterway Seaport. You have the environmentally conscious aluminum water bottle, the Waterway Seaport mask, two stickers, and that suspicious looking blue item is a reusable straw. So you can take that all around the world. Let's just double check. Are you my champions feeling ready for this tonight?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Ready.
Okay. I'm ready. I smell victory already.
You can taste it, meaty in the air. Well, I'm going to usher you guys into the green room while we go through this, and then we'll welcome you back onto the screen about 8:30. Let's just check the comments and make sure that everyone else is feeling ready. It's looking good. All right, my friends, I'll see you all very soon. For everyone else, thank you so much for joining us tonight. We have an exciting evening of history, humor, and competitive games all lined up for you. And for quite frankly, none of this would be possible at all without, of course, the Foss Waterway Seaport and their virtual Third Thursday program, but also through the generous contributions of Columbia Bank.
I've been a commercial fisherman for 41 years. Truly is a magical place out there. I've been with Columbia Bank as long as this boat's been to sea. As a commercial fisherman, we have income pulses that are directly related to seasonal activities. If that propeller ain't turning, you're not earning. Columbia Bank tailored this loan to fit our business needs perfectly. They made me happy as a clam at high tide.
Well, for those of you who are endemic to the Pacific Northwest region, you have no doubt encountered the times and voyages of Captain George Vancouver, just going to school here, honestly. But tonight, I want to recap a little bit of that exciting voyage, and to those people who are not from this area, give you a little bit more to know about this guy. But here is the star of our show tonight, Captain George Vancouver, born on the 22nd of June, 1757, and then passed away on May 10th, 1798, if I'm not mistaken. And he was a British naval officer, a snappy dresser, and one of those gentleman explorers that really, I think, is representative of that sort of golden age of sail in the late 1700s. He actually got his first commission when he joined the Royal Navy at the tender age of 13 and served as a midshipman under Captain James Cook. And together they explored the vast Pacific. And it was their voyage that was the first European expedition to go to the Hawaiian Isles, which they called the Sandwich Isles at the time. And from then, his Royal Naval career only expanded onwards and upwards. But he is most famous for the Vancouver expedition, aptly named, which brought him all the way across the Atlantic, all throughout the Pacific Ocean, and then eventually here to the then named Puget Sound. And here are some of the most famous areas in the area, all of which were charted by Vancouver. And I do think that's an important distinction. We're not going to say discovered tonight, because there were people living there who knew about it from a long time before. But Vancouver was the first European into the area who made expansive charts, although he did have a very fierce rivalry with Spain. And the Spanish government, which was in this like on again, off again thing with England, so needy and clingy. But they were not only both trying to chart the Pacific, but they were sometimes at war, sometimes at not. So when Vancouver got the command of the HMS Discovery and was sent out to the Pacific, he was really sent out to claim land back from Spain after they ceded it back to the British. It's a convoluted back and forth on the whole thing. But what's important is he had two main objectives. One, to put Spain in their place, and two, to create charts and maps of the area. And that he did. He did it with aplomb. Like, successful. He didn't actually have a plum on board, but that is going to come very handy later, your knowledge of citrus on board. Like I said, he sailed first with Captain James Cook, and then it wasn't until the 1790s that he came back and started to chart the area. And it was on, I think, April 1st, 1791, that he was dispatched from England with the purpose of charting so much of the Pacific. And he did. And I think probably his greatest achievement was naming things. When we look at all of the various things that Vancouver did, putting names on maps was far and away number one. But number two was in his ability to have cordial relationships with almost everyone. And I put the caveat on there with good purpose. Vancouver was really quite famous for his ability to have friendly relationships with American sailors, with Spanish sailors, and also with the indigenous people that he came across. Very much so at the time, in the 1700s, he was revolutionary in his approach to dealing with the indigenous peoples that he came across. While a lot of people took a very violent approach to it, Vancouver was deeply empathetic in a time when that was really not in vogue. So credit where credit is due. He first got to experience sort of the voyages on the Pacific when he was working with Captain James Cook and was actually there on that fateful voyage where James Cook was killed in the Hawaiian Islands. If you don't know that story, it is a lengthy, elaborate, and very interesting one that I'm only going to kind of touch on tonight. But Cook was very much a golden age explorer, had really good relationships with a lot of people, but things went sideways with his relationship with the people living on the Hawaiian Isles. And when a child was murdered by a rogue bullet, things really went crazy. Captain Cook was murdered in that scuffle and then returned. His body was treated like a king and then returned to the British Navy. A lot going on with this whole thing. But Vancouver took that time on the Hawaiian Isles and then patched it into a really good working relationship. And this is a picture of King Kamehameha I's decisive victory on Oahu as he shoves another army literally off a cliffside. And a big portion of this victory is attributed to the help that Captain Vancouver gave to King Kamehameha I, including a great deal of cannons, some aid from his carpenters, and so on and so forth. King Kamehameha I ends up signing there's some debate as to what this decree actually goes towards, whether it was a surrender of the Hawaiian Isles over to the British government, or it was a peace agreement looking for an alliance and a partnership. But one way or the other, King Kamehameha I recognized that there was going to be greater danger not being allied with the British than there would be signing over to them. And so he cedes the Hawaiian Isles over to Vancouver. But in 1791, the real exploration of our region begins in earnest. And Vancouver was dispatched with two ships, the HMS Discovery and the HMS Chatham, and they took off. The Chatham was a much smaller, it was a four-gunned ship, which was just supposed to act as a gunboat tender and sort of ride shotgun with the Discovery, providing support when they needed it. And it ends up becoming more famous in the region than the HMS Discovery, arguably. The things that we are probably most familiar with are, again, the names that Vancouver left behind. He went on a crazy naming spree, putting over 200 major landmarks on actual maps and then having those published later on. Mount Baker here was named after his third lieutenant, Joseph Baker, who was the first person on the expedition to spot it. Mount St. Helens was named after his friend Alan Fitzherbert, the first Baron of St. Helens, the more you know. We also have, of course, the Puget Sound itself, which was named for the HMS Discovery's Lieutenant Peter Puget, who explored the southern reaches. He took off in a small craft and went off and named as many things as he possibly could and made very detailed and accurate charts at the time. And then, of course, this beauty right here. While traditionally named Tacoma, this mountain was renamed for Rainier, which is Admiral Peter Rainier, who actually, this is a big part of the reason that there's controversy over the mountain name today, because Peter Rainier not only fought against the U.S. during the Revolutionary War, but he had never been to the West Coast and had never seen the mountain. And actually, based on this portrait, I'm not sure that he had ever seen a mountain at all in his life. One of the other notable moments in the illustrious career of Captain George Vancouver is actually when he ran into this guy right here, who is Captain Robert Gray, the American captain, who was doing the same mission that Vancouver was at the same time, essentially trying to make accurate charts. And so several decades before Lewis and Clark made their way across the country, Captain Gray here actually took a ship up the Columbia River, which is a terrifying task on the best of days. But he managed to do it and was the first non-Indigenous person to probe that deeply into the heart of the Washington Territory, and certainly on the Columbia River up to that point. So pretty good. And what I hope to sort of illustrate here is the real accomplishment was, again, in his networking, was in his ability to get people to like him, both in his negotiating with the Hawaiian Isles, But also with Captain Gray there, while they were technically competitors, they were shouting back and forth at each other with their mega horns here and managed to strike a deal that they would exchange charts. So a great deal of Vancouver's research and charts came from Gray and vice versa. They had a pretty good rapport. But that isn't to say that Vancouver was universally loved. In fact, he was mostly hated by his own countrymen, and he actually encountered quite a bit of difficulties returning home to England. While he was really well accomplished and respected as an explorer, he wasn't very politically well connected, and the naturalist on board his ship, an Archibald Menzies, not pictured, really disliked him. And in fact, they had a major disagreement over who should get paid more. One of the things that happened was Vancouver operated occasionally as the ship's astronomer and naturalist at times, and so wanted to claim some of that pay for himself. And Menzies got real upset about that and took that beef back home to England. And so they had a major falling out over that. By far, the person that, in my opinion, hated Vancouver the most was this gentleman right here. Now, here's the thing. This is Mr. Pitt. He is the Lord of Camelford. And just based on this picture alone, you can make a lot of assumptions about this dude. And I'm going to go ahead and say that the majority of them were accurate. But let's bring some humanity to this moment. Young Pitt here signed on for this ocean-going voyage just because his parents were like, you got to get out. You're not going to be a lord anytime soon, and you're annoying the hell out of us. There's some subtext here, but bear with me. Almost immediately on the voyage, he is finding himself with problems up the wazoo. And a big part of them was that he was 16. He was, by all accounts, a real just pain. And he had a propensity for stealing things from the ship and then using them to pay women for sex. Never a good practice when your commander at the time is a very strict, very proper British dude, which George Vancouver was, which got him a great deal of respect from his peers around the world, but almost no respect from his crewmen. So when they actually got to Tahiti, young Pitt here stripped a piece of iron off the ship and tried to essentially buy a young Tahitian woman with it, and Vancouver caught him and flogged him, and this was the beginning of their downhill relationship. Every opportunity that Pitt had to act up, he took. Again, he's 16, he's rich, he's nobility, but there weren't any other officer positions available on the ship when he signed on, so he was just a regular sailor on this ship. And it was a recipe for disaster. So much so that by the time they got back, two things had transpired while they were away at sea for those several years. One is that the Lord Camelford had died, and now young Pitt here was the man in charge, very politically connected, very, very rich, and had a reputation for taking people out and just blowing money on debauchery. So people liked him. The other thing is that he decided on the voyage home that he was going to launch an all-out campaign against Vancouver. And when Vancouver arrived back to England, Pitt, pictured here on the left, sent him this long, like, Dear John letter listing everything that he had ever done to him, sent it to him. And when Vancouver was like, okay, I guess I'm just going to carry on living my life. He discarded the letter, and that was too much for William Pitt. So he went out in the street, challenged Vancouver to a duel. And when Vancouver, double his age, was like, whoa, bro, relax. I'm not going to fight you. Everything that you're upset about was when I was your captain. We don't have any personal problems. And then that just put him right over the roof. So here is an illustration from the time of when William Pitt took a cane and beat Captain George Vancouver in the street. For those of you curious, this pretty much is an accurate representation of the rest of William Pitt's life. He went off half-cocked every opportunity he got, beating anyone who made less money than him until he eventually died and was labeled half mad because he only beat poor people, so they weren't too upset with him. Vancouver, however, really takes a sharp turn after this, and just a couple years after arriving back from his voyage, before all his research is even published, he eventually dies in 1798 at the age of 40. That's less than 3 years after coming home from his voyage throughout the Puget Sound, and he's buried now in the churchyard of St. Peter, just in the London borough of Richmond. While he is very widely respected as one of the most notable explorers who achieved the greatest amount for the great empire of England, a lot of that came after his death, and there wasn't a ton of recognition for his accomplishments at the time, and he really died in relative obscurity, which is sad, really. But not to worry, he put his name on everything. while they were out voyaging around, the biggest accomplishment at the time was going and essentially reclaiming areas that Spain had already taken. And one of the big drawbacks to that was that when he arrived there, the Spanish were still there and no one had a cell phone at the time to be like, hey, we're at war, we're not at war. So they were on uneven ground for the whole thing, but they managed to work it out. Just in case you're curious, because I imagine we're going to get some questions about it, the HMS Discovery actually had a more notable and long-lasting career than Captain George Vancouver. It went on to be used as an exploration and military vessel with its 10 guns over a series of years. And then eventually, here's a breakdown on the timeline, was pivotal in the Battle of Copenhagen, then became a hospital ship, and then eventually ended its career after they de-rigged it and left it as a floating prison ship off the coast of England, pictured here. That was the end of its career until after they decommissioned it at a prison in the early 1800s, it was burned to the ground. There is a replica of the HMS Discovery today sailing around, but the original is now just ash at the bottom of the Atlantic. Like I said, there are some significant moments to take away from this entire thing here. One of them is Vancouver's relationship with the Spanish. In fact, when he arrived there, the notable captain at the time, whose name is so amazing, I gotta see if I can find it for you guys here really quick. They made an agreement where they were like, tell you what, we're both here, let's name the island together. And so they did. So for a period there, it was Vancouver and I can't remember it. I'm hoping that someone in the comments here will be able to give it to me. And if not, it'll come back to me here in a moment. But Vancouver and his Spanish counterpart, the famed Spanish explorer who was out there at the exact same time, were like, you know what? Let's just split it. So they both surveyed Vancouver Island and they named it something than Vancouver. However, after Vancouver left, he just shuffled the other name off of it. And he was like, this is Vancouver Island now. Bob Smith is a good guess, but it's not. Oh man, we're gonna come back to it. One thing that I really want you to bear in mind, there's two ships pictured here. Of course, the HMS Discovery is over here on the left, and then on the right is the Chatham. And the Chatham was under the command of Lieutenant William Robert Broughton, who was working with Vancouver on this voyage. And this was the gun tender that went everywhere with it. And Chatham was responsible for a lot of the secondary exploration throughout the area, creating a lot of those charts. And a big thing that he had going for him was a smaller vessel. So he could go in places where the Discovery could not. And it's interesting because in 1792, while they were exploring around what are now the San Juan Islands, they lost an anchor. The tide came up so aggressively that they just got whipped out, and They had several anchors on board the vessel, which was the tradition at the time. You'd have two major bowers up front, which were your heaviest anchors, and then you would have a stream anchor, which was used for just like normal day-to-day anchoring, and they lost the stream anchor, got snapped right off of that. Now, there is a wide deal of speculation that it was found in 2014. People who were doing some fishing diving in the area found this anchor pictured right here, and based on the historic records, are confident that it is the anchor in question. It was one of the greatest discoveries at the time, but there's a healthy faction of people who think that this anchor is in fact not the right anchor. The biggest argument for it being a false anchor is that it's about 100 to 200 pounds heavier than what you would have encountered of a traditional anchor, stream anchor on a vessel at that time. The other thing is that there's not an exact account of where it was lost, but you all may remember Bob Mester, explorer, treasure hunter, diver, who's worked with the seaport in the past and been on a few of our encounters. He's actually confident that he knows the location of that anchor. And so we might be talking more about this in the upcoming future. But this is currently down in Texas, this particular anchor. It has been cleaned up, and they go through a process where they run it through a whole variety of things. They clean it with a tiny little jackhammer. Then they run it through a water with electrical current in it to pull the salt out of the iron, and then they coat it. But this particular anchor is now down in Texas. It sometimes comes back up to the area on display, but it's a contested historic artifact as to whether or not this is the most famous missing artifact from the Vancouver expedition. One thing that I think is pretty notable, though, from this picture is that you can see the craft that they were using. And what they would do is they would take the HMS Discovery, anchor her somewhere safe, and then either take the Chantham or these smaller boats here, rig them up with a sail and some oars, and do the majority of their cartography and chart making in one of these. So, whew, there we go. Quadra, thank you. Captain Quadra, and I wish I could remember his whole name. It's something so extraordinary, but I'll find it for you guys. Don't worry. So I think with that, we're arriving now at the point where I'm going to bring everyone back in. Do you guys want to say anything briefly about yourselves to encourage people to vote for you as their champion? I think you do. Let's start with Jackie. What sets you apart?
I have a lot of false confidence. It has gotten through me through all of my life so far. So I have that to bring to the table.
I love it. That's really, you're coming in very strong, and I appreciate it.
Exactly. That's what I'm talking about.
Kayla, what about yourself? What really sets you apart for this competition?
You know, the imposter syndrome just doesn't exist in this world right here. So we're just going to stay calm, cool, collected, and we're going to win.
That's love it. You guys have already made me very, very happy. Lucas, how about yourself?
I have nothing to say.
Quiet confidence, you know, which I think is often underrated. So at this point, we're going to give you guys just a couple seconds. Put your champion's name in the comments. Our esteemed Julia with the seaport is going to put those names down. And then if your champion wins at the end of this, you will be entered into a rapid drawing to see who gets the fantastic prize package.
Ooh.
Shown right here. Again, it's the water bottle, two stickers, that wonderful pandemic proof mask, and the reusable straw, which if nothing else is a conversation starter for all of your parties that you're not having right now. let's jump into this. You guys feeling confident and ready?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I got that feeling. Fact or fiction? It's very simple. All you do is thumbs up if you think it's fact, thumbs down if you think it's fiction. Here we go. Number one, Captain George Vancouver helped construct a large warship for King Kamehameha I. All right, let's see here. We've got Jackie, Kayla, and Lucas all on the true bandwagon. Congratulations, you. It is true. That's a point for all of you. And yes, George Vancouver commissioned or commanded his carpenters as part of this peace agreement he had with Kamehameha to build a 30-foot-6 schooner-rigged vessel replete with cannons that he had lying around. And that was responsible for a lot of the devastation that Kamehameha rained down on his rival kings, thus uniting the Hawaiian Isles for the first time ever. I don't know if we applaud this, but it's true. The greatest danger on the voyage was the weather. True or false? All right. False. I'm proud to announce, yes, you're all correct yet again. Does anyone want to hazard a guess what the true killer was?
Disease.
Yeah. what is it that you're obsessed with right now? Lack of vitamin C?
That's scurvy. Right. Scurvy.
Scurvy. Yeah, scurvy.
Let me tell you something, my friends. From the 15th to the 18th century, scurvy alone claimed just north of 2 million lives.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah, in case you weren't worried, this could happen to anyone.
Ooh, you had this ready to go?
This is what happens. After you don't get enough vitamin C, you are depleted of the collagen in your body. And not only do you start to fall apart, your gums rot out, but wounds that you've had previously will reopen.
Gross.
Yep, bones will re-break.
Eat oranges.
That's the true killer here is scurvy.
Okay.
So you become a zombie then?
Essentially, yes.
Whoa.
Yes. It's horrifying. Never forget. Vancouver's naming spree caused a lot of confusion in 2010. True or false?
I'm not going first.
Okay, wait, can we not all like answer? I liked, somebody said you should count to three and we all have to answer at the same time. And I want to go with Tawny on that one. How do we feel?
Okay, let's do it. 1, 2, 3.
I wasn't ready. Okay.
All right, I've got Lucas for true, Kayla for false, Jackie for true. And yes, the answer is true.
Oh!
Dang. Gosh, darn. Sorry.
Yeah, and does anyone want to hazard a guess why?
I don't even remember the question.
That's the right answer. Yeah, during the 2010 Winter Olympics, which were held in Vancouver, British Columbia, Vancouver, Washington, also named for our late great captain, was overwhelmed with booking requests of people who were trying to go to Vancouver, Washington to see the Olympics. Mm-hmm. Not as exciting, might I just add. All right, here's a good one. Captain Vancouver personally explored more of the Puget Sound than any other European up to that point. 3, 2, 1. True. I'm sorry to say you're all misinformed.
Ooh.
Answer is false.
Ooh.
While Captain Vancouver, this is an important part of this, personally, while Captain Vancouver was responsible for the expedition into the Puget Sound, the name is the real clue here. Lieutenant Peter Puget. Lieutenant Peter Puget was actually dispatched on a smaller vessel to go and explore the majority of the Puget Sound, and his charts and exploration are responsible for that.
Vancouver got beat out by another white guy, huh?
It's brutal, right?
Brutal out there for them.
And in fact, this lovely picture right here is the reason why Peter Puget was sent south all by his lonesome. This is when the HMS Discovery ran aground. Because they didn't have any charts at the time, they were sort of just guessing. They're like, I don't think there's a... Oh, it's a rock. And so they just had to wait till there was a higher tide and then pull that sucker off.
Mm.
Not even remotely fun, I'm assuming. Mm. Here's, this is common knowledge, I assume. Captain Cook always insisted on traveling with several tons of sauerkraut. Three.
I mean, something silly like two, several ounces.
One. I've got two trues and
Lucas.
You didn't answer. That counts as no answer.
All right, Jackie, Kayla,
false.
The trues have it.
Woo!
It's true. While he wasn't aware of the fact that pickled cabbage contained a high concentration of vitamin C and thus prevented scurvy, Captain Cook was the first to notice that sauerkraut did he thought it was like a good luck charm. Like if it was on the voyage, people didn't get this weird disease. And at the time, they really thought that scurvy was something contagious. They didn't realize it was a lack of vitamins. But he would always order several tons of sauerkraut to be kept in the hold of the ship. And he had to do a whole like propaganda campaign for it. He would have the officer's table up on deck every now and then. And he would put sauerkraut in like a silver bowl. And he would be like, oh, eat it like it's the best thing in your life. And then the able-bodied seaman would be like, oh, damn. I don't know what that is, but it looks good. And he would trick them into eating sauerkraut.
You'd have to trick me too.
I mean, come on. It's delicious.
It's called fact, gross.
I think this is pretty incredible as far as the scientific process of it. But based on, they've taken sketches and accounts and they've actually created a pretty accurate film of what life would have looked like on board the HMS Discovery, which I'm going to share with everyone right now.
Got a whale of a tale to tell you, lads, a whale of a tale or two, about the flapping fish and the girls I've loved on nights like this with the moon above. A whale of a tale, and it's all true, I swear by my tattoo. There was Mermaid Minnie, met her down in Madagascar, she would kiss me anytime that I would ask her. Then one evening, her flame of love blew out. Blow me down and pick me up, she swapped me for a trout. Got a whale of a tale to tell you, lads, a whale of a tale or two, about the flapping fish and the girls I've loved on nights like this with the moon above. A whale of a tale, and it's so true, I swear by my tattoo.
Yeah, if you guys aren't familiar with the Kirk Douglas rendition of Whale of a Tale,
yeah.
Vintage butt wriggle. No, that wasn't from the HMS Discovery, but I've been looking for an opportunity to inject that clip for a while now. So thank you all for that. Let's get back into the real pulse-pounding questions here, shall we?
Yep.
Vancouver accidentally started a cowboy movement. True or false?
I mean,
I don't think so.
Got one false.
Was it an accident?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of minutiae in these whole things here.
I'm risking
it. 3, 2, 1. All right. Kayla, Jackie, yet again, congratulations. It is true.
Oh!
Completely a fun historic footnote here, but Vancouver brought along several flocks of sheep and cattle on his voyage across the Atlantic and the Pacific, and gifted King Kamehameha I one flock of sheep, one bull, and 5 longhorns. And in so doing, started a cattle culture on Hawaii. And King Kamehameha, having no animals like that ever before on the islands, actually sent away for Filipino vaqueros, like ranch hands, who had been trained by the Spanish. And they showed up and are the birth of the paniolo, or the Hawaiian cowboy. So starting in the 1790s, the first ranch hand cowboy starts in Hawaii, and decades before the American cowboy became something that was well known in the area, or even a thing, really.
I
before there were ranches.
Because of all of my sheep history that I know. So.
I was going to say, I was very confident in your knowledge of husbandry. Captain Vancouver led the HMS Discovery up the Columbia River. True or false? I've got one false, two false, three falses. Congratulations, all of you. It is false. Yes. The Columbia River here is treacherous on the best of days, and the most daunting aspect of it is the bar, an invisible subaquatic sandbar that changes based on the river current and the tide, and is notorious for destroying large vessels. And when the HMS Discovery arrived here, he actually dispatched the Chantham up the Columbia. They made it safely, but the crew at the time was already suffering from scurvy and didn't have the strength or the wherewithal to get onto the Columbia. Which brings us to our next question. True or false, scurvy is the worst. Yes. Congratulations, everyone. Scurvy is the worst. There is no disease more horrible. 2 million. 2 million sailors. All right.
That's wild.
I like Julian Wheeler's question because I'm from the other Vancouver. So
both get named Vancouver because they were stops for Vancouver. Captain Vancouver was the first person to successfully chart the fact that Vancouver Island up in British Columbia was an island. That was unknown information until he completed his expedition. And the Vancouver area was one of the only sort of safe places near the Columbia River. So both he was like, I like it. It's going to get my name.
All right.
And yeah, of course I'm scared of scurvy. Nobody wants their body to lose its collagen and pull itself apart as you go mad. That's ridiculous. So Vancouver co-named the largest island he charted with his Spanish buddy. I should know this.
Yes.
Yes. The answer is true. You all get more points. Congratulations. Yes, it was, and I've got the name for you now. Capitán Señor Don Juan Francisco de la Bodega y Cuadra. Who was this good looking dude right here. And like as famous as Vancouver and Cook were, Bodega y Cuadra was like the most. He was the Spanish playboy. People loved this dude. He was good looking. He was confident. He explored all up and down the Pacific coast. And he was actually already there at Vancouver Island when Vancouver showed up. So while Vancouver and Puget get the credit for exploring all that southern portion down there, basically the whole Strait of Juan de Fuca and a majority of Vancouver Island had already been charted by Don Juan Francisco de la Bodega y Cuadra. And they were really good pals, interestingly enough. Despite the on-again, off-again warlike relationship, Vancouver and Cuadra were on the ship together. They would have lunch all the time. And they're like, you know what? Let's combine our charts. And they did. So again, it was Cuadra and Vancouver Island until Vancouver was like, nope, I think we'll just shuffle your name right off the chart here.
Wow.
American Captain Robert Gray is accurately portrayed in his portrait. False, false, false. You guys are nailing it tonight. It is false, but for such a strange reason. Gray had an eye patch for almost the entirety of his life. And this statue of the Maritime Museum down on the Oregon coast and this rare charcoal sketch of him are the only places that accurately depict him with his eye patch. But yeah, in all of the official portraiture of him, they never paint him with the eye patch. But I'm like, what a cool guy.
Yeah, that would add to your awesomeness.
You would think, right? Like eye patches are so in vogue, especially at the time. Vancouver Expedition had all 154 crew on its muster on board. And just to clarify, the muster was the official list of everyone on board when they departed.
Ah, can we do a 1, 2, 3 for this one?
Let's do a 1, 2, 3. False, false, false. Man, there's no getting anything past you guys tonight. It is False. And here's why. It had 153 active members on board the crew.
I knew you.
The 154th was a widow's man.
Hmm.
And this was the early pension system where they would just put an imaginary person on the muster, and then all of the pay that was going to go to that person would be given to someone's widow if they died on the voyage.
Mm. Cool.
And that was a common practice at the time, but only for the Royal Navy. If you're going to be a merchant mariner and you died, your wife was done. But if you're part of the Royal Navy, they just squirreled that extra money away with their punked up roster. And here's a good one. The expedition covered over 80 plus miles in small boats. I'll count down.
Yep.
One, two, three.
Wow. Wait, I'm changing mine.
Oh, Jackie, you should have stuck with it.
Oh, no.
The answer is true.
We're getting too boring.
Virtual high five, Lucas.
Hundreds of miles, in fact, and these little beauties right here, they would send them out. In fact, on his birthday, Captain Vancouver was on board one of these 84 miles away from the HMS Discovery, which they found very quickly was prone to running aground in the unknown waters of the Puget Sound. So the majority of their expedition was done on these man-made, man-propelled craft throughout the area. You guys familiar with the 7048 by any chance?
Yes.
It is a sweet expedition where people go from the Foss waterway, like right outside the seaport, up to Port Townsend. It's a 70-mile journey, and you have 48 hours to complete it, and you have to be in a human-powered craft.
Yeah, I have heard about this, actually.
Some people do it on stand-up paddleboards. Some people do it on rowboats. It's bananas. But next time you have the offer to do the 7048, just remember, these dudes did it. And they were suffering from scurvy at the time.
You're right. I want to be just like those dudes.
So we're going to take a moment here because, oh my gosh.
I think you need a tiebreaker, don't you?
Well, yeah, the thing is, yeah, your indecision there brought it all back.
I would have won.
Okay. So here it is. Here's your tiebreaker, Jackie. Okay. Kayla. Fact or fiction? There are four women that Kirk Douglas sings about in that rendition of Whale of a Tale from 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Four women that he sings about.
Are you going to count us down?
I am.
Okay.
Your answer is in 3, 2, 1.
Uh-oh.
Well, you're both right, unfortunately. Okay.
Of course he would sing about four of them. It's Kirk Douglas.
Let's do a answer to the best of your ability.
Oh, God.
How many dogs were on board the HMS Discovery when it embarked on its voyage?
Closest without going over?
Closest without going over. Anytime now.
Who has to answer first?
Let's start with Jackie.
Hold up fingers? Why don't we hold up fingers?
Okay. Fingers. I'm going to count it down. 3, 2, 1. Okay. Well, here's the problem. We're just going to have to go with closest. Uh-huh. Because zero is the answer.
Oh!
Zero dogs. Also, embarked. That's genius.
That's good.
Woo! Zero dogs. Okay, woo-hoo! So that means our official winner is Jackie. Congratulations on your pulse-pounding, exciting win. As is the arrangement I've made, Jackie now gets a hand-forged good from myself over at Pretty Gritty Tours. And in just a second, our associate Julia is going to pick a random name here. And you guys ready for it? Katie Rose.
Oh.
Katie Rose is the new winner of this fine prize package right here. So, Katie, if you please send us a message over at Pretty Gritty Tours, we are going to find a way to get that to you. I have no control over it whatsoever, but I will make sure that it's done. With that, I really want to extend a very sincere thank you to my contestants, my champions tonight for joining us, and to all of you for joining us on this exciting voyage. Next month, we are going to be doing for the free virtual Thursday, the SS Governor, which is a shipwreck in the Puget Sound that had some of the wealthiest people from the Seattle area on board when it sank to the bottom of the sea and where it still remains today. You guys can be more excited.
Wow.
Well, Lucas, Kayla, Jackie, thank you all so much for joining me. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you all have a fantastic evening. I will see you all very soon. Until then, keep on exploring. Eat your frickin' vitamin C.